debts are canceled. Oh yes, prisoners are released. It's Jubilee. It's Jubilee time. Debts are paid. This is the time that God is saying, I'm going to give you increase. Penti, 50 days after the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. 50 days after Easter, we call this Pentecost. It's when the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter number 2 was fully come. When it was fully come, we're here 50 days, fully come. It's here now that the Holy Spirit came and showered down on the first church, the new church, as we know it today, under grace and truth. And this is where we are today. We are in the Spirit of God, the power of God, and thanking Him for what the Lord has done. Come on, this is Pentecost. This is Pentecost time. And I'm here to tell you, the Lord is moving by His power and moving by His Spirit. Come on, share me, like me. I want you to share me, like me. Don't hate me. It's Pentecost time. I'm glad to be with you. Hallelujah. God is good all the time. And I'm here to tell you, all the time, God is good. Let's look at Acts chapter number 2. I want to remain contextual as we look at this great Pentecost Sunday. Acts chapter number 2. And it is in verse number 1, New Testament passages. This is Luke's gospel. Actually, he wrote the book of St. Luke. And then the second volume is the Acts, or the Actions of the Apostle. And he's writing to one man, O Theophilus. But when he writes to him, giving him a more excellent way, and also the actions of the apostle is what the apostles did after Easter, after Jesus' death, his burial, and his resurrection. Now we begin to see their ministry in full bloom, blossoming to its fullest potential. In Acts chapter number 2, verse number 1, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all, the King James Version said, with one accord in one place. If I can just get the church just to be in one place and on one accord, that's right. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, when this time, this appointment with destiny, there are two words I want to give you. One is chronos, and the other one is kairos. Chronos, put that in the comments, chronos. It's spelled C-H-R-O-N-O-S, chronos. And chronos actually deals with sequential time. It's like you can look at your watch, that's chronos time. Look at your calendar, that's chronos time. And when the day, it's measured time. Even you can take, if you were the old hour glass and put salt in it. And then over time, that's measured time, sequential time on the day of Pentecost. That's right. But when you deal with kairos time, there are several spellings. And here is one of many spellings, K-I-A-R-O-S, kairos. Kairos is another word that deals with an appointment with destiny before, listen to this, the foundation of the world, before the world began, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come. So in other words, today was predestined, predetermined before the foundation of the world. And so I want you to understand this definite article that actually deals with when this day, when it has fully come, when the day of Pentecost has fully come. That's right, Pentecost is the word Penti or Pentecost. It's another word that means Passover. It deals with a Jewish festival every 50 years. Years of sevens, weeks of seven, years of seven. Seven times seven is 49. And that following year would be Pentecost. It's a Jewish celebration. It means 50th. And so here this celebration, when the day of Pentecost has fully come, you'll find that word here in Pentecost in Acts 2 and verse number 1, and also Acts chapter 20, for my note tech, is verse 16. For Paul had determined to sail by Ephesus because he would not spend the time in Asia, for he hasted if it were possible for him to be back at Jerusalem the day of Pentecost. So Pentecost was a great Jewish feast, great Jewish celebration, when everybody who moved away, families from all over, came back home on the day of Pentecost. Some of them came from different places all over the world, and they moved out and moved away. And so, but when they came, the Lord is talking about those different tongues, different languages, from Parthians, from Medes, from Elamites, of dwellers in Mesopotamia and in Judea. If you look at Acts chapter 2, verse 9, you also see where they came from. These were Jews that were scattered abroad. They're from Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, dwellers of Mesopotamia. They came from everywhere. They came from Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia. They also came from Egypt. They came from Africa and Libya and about Cyrene, strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes. They came, verse 11 said, they came from Crete, and the Arabs were there. Lord have mercy. And we heard them all speaking our own tongue. So here it is on the day of Pentecost, 50 year Jewish celebration. And so when it was fully come, they were all with one. Somebody say one. Put one on you in the comments. One. Singleness. One. Unanimously. With one accord. One mind. One spirit. If I can get the church just to get to that one. Come on, put one down there. Oneness with God. It's possible for your body to be somewhere and your mind is elsewhere. When you deal with this one, God not only wants your body present, he wants your soul, your will, your imagination. That's right. He wants what you want, your desires, to desire what he wants. Be on one accord. And I'm here to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, saints, and then, of course, there's some ain'ts out there too. Lord have mercy. You got to learn how to get on one accord. Be oneness in mind with God. The Bible said they were one accord, and one accord. That word accord is nothing. It's like a musical term. Homothumadon is the Greek word. In other words, one mind, one sound, one vision, one voice. They were one accord. They had things in common. If you can get the church, the believers, to be in one mind, one spirit, oh, the devil don't have no room to conquer. Put that in the comments. One mind, one voice, one sound. And that's what God is calling for, one voice, one mind. When you do that, Satan is already defeated. He's already defeated. Come on, somebody put that in the comments. He's already defeated. If I can get an audience of one with God, you tell the devil you don't matter. You're saying to the enemy, it doesn't matter what you've done, what you said. I believe God. And the biblical text says when they were one accord and in one place, they weren't shuffling and moving all over the place. You know, here they, you're part of this church this week, next week somewhere else. And then the following month you somewhere else, next year you someone else. They're just all over the place. You got to learn how to grow where you're planted. Get in one place. In other words, stop all that moving around. It's harder to build and you keep moving the foundation. That's going to be a shaky foundation. It's hard to plant and you keep on uprooting it and planting it over here, then uprooting it and planting it over there. It's hard to have fruit on a plant that's constantly being uprooted and replanted, constantly uprooted and replanted. God wants you to understand that you're going to have challenges. I don't care where you go. I don't care who you talk to, who you with. Number one, you have to know, what is the Lord saying? What is the Lord's will? They got in one place and one accord. They didn't have all that movement around. You know, we live in a day and age now where many don't respect. They don't respect the word. They don't respect prayer. They don't respect the things of God. They come in God. I've seen folks come in God's house just talking like they're at the park. Service is in full motion. They got a whole conversation going on. Lord have mercy. You would think if you got that much to say, call them after service. Maybe you should go by and visit. Maybe y'all need to go to dinner and hang out. But don't do it on God's time. Let the people that came to church receive what they came to receive, and that is the word of God. Nothing should be more important in the house of the Lord when the service of the Lord is in motion than what's taking place. You don't know when God is going to move. Put it in the comments. Be of one mind. Be of one mind. You don't know when God's going to move. When I come in, I'm glad to see you. Let me hug you, shake your hand, maybe bump you. We can do that. But don't hold me up and hold the conversation. Let me get in the worship. Let me get in the praise. Let me get in on the move of God that's already taking place. Because I need to get, if you're like me, I need all I can. And I need to can all I can get and get all I can. Because I need God like my God. I need God every single day. I need him more than the oxygen, the air that I breathe in and out. Is anybody out there that can holler back at your boy and say hallelujah, amen, or your preacher apostle? I need all I can get. The Bible said they were with one accord and in one place. And when that happened, verse 2 of Acts chapter 2 says, and suddenly, somebody put in the comments, and suddenly, it's the word aphno. It's a Greek word, aphno. And I don't use these Greek words to show pseudo scholarship, but I use it to understand the culture of the text. What is it saying? And suddenly, and unawares, unexpectedly. In other words, it's a contradiction of what was going on already. Suddenly, it actually changed what was already taking place. They didn't know it was going to happen. It was just unaware, unexpectedly. It was so quick and suddenly. And I'm here to tell the church, when you get in one place and one accord, God will show up. Somebody type in all caps, suddenly. That's right. We need him suddenly. Anybody need God right now? This is Pentecost Sunday. When you get in one place and one accord, suddenly. Don't make me start hollering. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Suddenly. Bible say, and all at quick, fast, and a hurry, and all at once, there came a sound from heaven. That's right, there came a sound, and I'm here to tell you, there's some sounds. There are different types of sounds, but there came a sound. The Greeks look at it as the word ice. It's actually spelled E-I-S, but it's pronounced ice, like I-C-E, E-I-S. It's a primary preposition. The sound indicating a point that is reached, indicating a place or a time. This word sound indicates figuratively, it deals with purpose. The sound deals with the result. Put in the comments, the result. Among or at, this word sound far more exceeding. This sound is the intent of God's purpose, his heart. It deals with my God. The intent, God's intent, there was a sound. In other words, you can have a sound, and with sound that you hear, you have the ability for what was heard, that sound. So you hear movement, you hear things happening, but just because you have a sound, don't mean you understand how to interpret that sound. There's a difference in hearing and listening. When you hear, you have the ability for sound. But when you listen, then now you can interpret the sound that was heard. So I want you to understand, there's a sound that God is releasing in the earth realm. Oh, there's a sound that God is releasing right where you are. You tune into the right Facebook podcast today, because I'm talking about a sound. You got to give God and in an environment that he can work with. The sound, you got to give God an environment, create the environment so God can move. When you give the right sound, I'm here to tell you, the right sound from heaven, enemies get moved back in a backward position. The right sound would alert the angels in heaven to be on release. When you have the right sound, heaven gets the news. The right sound gets God's attention. And right now, I want you to start typing in Jesus, 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 Jesus. What better sound than what heaven recognized? Come on, type it in all caps, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I need a sound that gets God's attention. What is God's name? His name is Jesus. What is God's name? Oh, yes, he came down to 40 and two generations. What is God's name? There's a sound that even demons tremble when you start calling on the name of Jesus. There came a sound from heaven, as it were, from heaven, from the heavenly lease, as it were, of a rushing, mighty, listen to these adjectives, rushing, mighty wind. Sound like a tsunami, kind of like, my God, an earthquake, a tornado. Sound. And there's certain sounds, you know what it means. Certain sounds, you know, when you start hearing thunder, thunderous sound, you know, the potential rain is real close. My God, when you start hearing a sound of a horn by train tracks, then you know that train is coming up. When I was a little child, my God, there was that nursery rhymes on an ice cream truck. I knew my ice cream was real close. Do I have any ice cream lovers out there? Amen. Some of y'all had that. What do you call that? What do you call the ice cream that's red, right, and blue, like a popsicle? The bomb. That's right. And you had how about that pink ice cream with the pink crust outside? They call that the parfait, right? Strawberry crunch. That's what I said. Strawberry crunch. That's what it is. Strawberry crunch. Some of y'all like that brown ice cream, the chocolate crunch. But when ice cream truck came, I mean, as kids, we started running toward the ice cream truck. The ice cream truck is coming. But you know what? Not only was I excited about the sound of the ice cream truck as a child, when I hear the sound of the ice cream truck, I get excited now. Lord have mercy. My mind goes back to that strawberry crunch. Lord, how I can't find no ice cream lovers out there. But I'm talking about a sound. There's a sound that when you get in praise and worship, that creates the atmosphere for God to move. There's a sound. Woo! Come on, write the word sound in the comments. And suddenly, when they got in one place, one accord, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a, listen to these adjectives, rushing, mighty wind. It was so filled, the Bible said that it filled all the house where they were seated, where they were sitting. The sound filled the entire room. Lord have mercy. You know, from time to time, I'll be in the kitchen and I bake pies and a few pastries and that kind of stuff. And when I'm in the kitchen, I don't get in often, I'm too busy. But when I am in that kitchen, there's a smell that fills the room. Lord have mercy. There's a sound of praise that's fragrance to God that he smells when we send up our prayers. There's a sound of prayer. There's a sound that is sweet fragrance in the nostrils of God. There's a sound of praise that God says, I got to come down and get in the midst, because he dwells in the midst of your praise. There's a sound. Certain sounds will trigger certain emotions. And I'm here to tell you, when you get the right sound, heaven will get the news. And the Bible says it filled all the house. Like when I'm cooking, that smell fills all the house. Lord have mercy. That sound, I've been driving in my car, air conditioning on, my radio on, and then there's a car that pulled right alongside of me, and my radio's on, my air conditioner on, radio on, and I can hear his sound from the car two or three cars over. It's so loud and that bass is thumping so deep, it fills my entire car, and I'm driving with the radio on, air conditioner on, but there's a sound. There's some sound that'll root out smaller sound. There's some sounds that'll root out what's going on. I want you to get a sound in your praise. I want you to get a sound in your prayer that'll root out the noise that the enemy has produced. Oh, don't let me start shouting already here. That's why Psalms 100 says, make a joyful noise. Have a noise, have a sound that's full of joy. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And that's right, then serve the Lord with gladness. And I'm here, you got to come before his presence with singing and with gladness and thanksgiving. There's a sound. And I'm here to tell you on Pentecost Sunday, we're looking for a sound today. I'm talking about a sound that'll uproot my God hostility, a sound that'll give you a new mind, sound that'll give you a new perspective on life, a sound that will make the enemy tremble. Because at the name of Jesus, you start giving that sound, demons start to tremble and shake because they can't stand that sound. Don't ever pray and don't have the sound of Jesus on the end. In Jesus' name, whatever you do, put that sound that heaven recognized, the voice, hallelujah. Somebody type in again, we need a sound from heaven. We need a sound from heaven. When you get the right sound from heaven, I'm here to tell you, God will save your children, save your spouse. He'll deliver. Deliverance will show up. Oh, yeah, breakthrough. Oh, don't let me start jumping and shouting. Breakthroughs would happen when the sound is right. Come on, come on. I feel the Holy Ghost. I feel that we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We need the sound of God. The Bible says, and the sound came as a rushing mighty wind and filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto those of 120. Somebody say this was Peter's mother-in-law's house. Big, huge house. The 120 were upstairs. And they were waiting for the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit to come. And the Lord told them, after he told them, you tear this body down, but in 3 days, I'm going to raise it up again. Jesus now, as it were, with Jonah in the belly of the whale for 3 days and three nights. Jesus was in the cavity of the earth for 3 days and three nights. But he told them, I'm coming back. Let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, that's St. John 14:1. If you believe in God, you believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, would not have told you, but I'm gone away to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there ye may be also. Hallelujah. The Bible says that the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, the Lord said, I'm going to send him in my name. So whatever you need today, I'm here to tell you, we need a sound. And when the Lord told them, go to Jerusalem, after I am resurrected, go to Jerusalem and wait there until you have been endowed or showered down with power from on high. And this is what they've done. After Jesus' death, his burial, his resurrection, and then, of course, he appeared to my God, the men that were on the road. They were on the road talking to one another saying, oh, oh my God, the roads we made as they thought they saw a stranger, and they talked to the man as they were walking. They said, did not our hearts burn? Did you feel something? He was talking to us. They didn't realize they were talking to the resurrected Savior, Jesus. Then, of course, he appeared unto 50, 500. The Lord just kept appearing. Then he would walk through the doors. My God, just walk through the wall. Before he had to knock on the door, open the door, but after his resurrected body, he can walk through the walls. And then he appeared to his disciples. He said, I want y'all to go back to Jerusalem and wait till you have been endowed with power from on high. And when the Holy Ghost come, my God, I'm here to tell you, He's a keeping power. Somebody say the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. And then the Bible said they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. God began to speak through them. And somebody's watching me right now, listening right now, who need the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost, the word holy is a Greek word, hagios, H-A-G-I-O-S. Hagios is something that is blameless. It is ceremonial, it's consecrated, it's holy. Holy is another word meaning that is sacred, set apart for a specific use or function. Hagios, morally, is blameless. My God, the Holy Ghost. Holy is an adjective describing the ghost, and the word ghost is a spirit. Pneuma is the wind of God, the breath of God, the oxygen of God. When God exhale, we inhale, that's our breath. I feel the Holy Ghost. You remember when God formed man from the dust of the ground and called his name Adam? And Adam was not only his name, but Adam was also the label of every human who would be born. Adam would come through him. All creation, human life, Adam, including his wife, everybody would come through him. The first Adam, that was a physical man. God scooped up some dust and formed man, looked like a man, was a real man. Put in the comments, Adam, A-D-A-M, Adam, comes from the word Adama, which actually means red earth, dust, dirt. Adam, that's the root word Adam. So God scooped up some dirt and formed the man. He was a man, looked like a man, shaped like a man, smelled like a man, but this man had a problem. This man was a dead man until God breathed life. Come on, put that in the comments, life. Pneuma, oxygen, wind. And then when God breathed life into man's nostril, the Bible says, man became a living soul. A living soul. So I'm here to tell you today, we need that nefesh. We need the life, the oxygen, the wind of God. My God, the power of God to become a living mind, living spirit, living will, living imagination. Your soul is where you get your feelings, your emotion, your will, your imagination. Living soul. All souls belong to me, the Lord says, but every soul is not filled with the Holy Spirit. And you need the Holy Spirit living in your soul. Come on, we need them living in our soul. And the Bible said, and when they were in one place, one accord, all of a sudden there came a sound from heaven that filled all the house. And I'm here to tell you, this was 50 days after his death, burial, and resurrection that the Lord sent the Holy Ghost, Pentecost. This is Pentecost Sunday. We have power today. Put it in the comments, power. The Holy Ghost, the dunamis, the authority of God, the ability of God. There are several words for power, dunamis or exousia. That dunamis, like dynamite, is power. It's not just destructive, but it's also hallelujah. This word is also authority. This word is also, my God, having permission, granted will from God. It is the enabling, put in the comments, the enabling of God. I call this power super. When you get God super on your natural, you can do some supernatural things. The God we serve, he's supernatural, and he's naturally super. On this Pentecost, put in the comments, I need the power. I got to go, my time is up, but I'm here to tell you, we need the power of God. We need the enabling of God. And on this Pentecost Sunday, I'm here to tell you the power is here. I say the power is here. This is why Luke 11 and 13 talks about if you are evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more will your heavenly Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those that ask him? If you need the Holy Ghost, ask him for it. In John chapter 20, verse 22, And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. Put in the comments, breathe on me, Lord. We need him to breathe on us again. Paul's letter to the church of Ephesus, Ephesians 5, from a note taker's verse 18. Don't get drunk with wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. You know, wine's a spirit. He didn't say it was a sin to have wine. The first miracle Jesus made was turning water into wine. But he's talking about being filled, intoxicated with something that's going to override your will, your spirit, and now you own something else. If I'm going to be filled with wine or spirits, let me be filled with the Spirit and the power of God. I need him to override what the enemy's done, what he said, what he's doing in my life. Do I have anybody out there that can put some amens out there? Come on, amen in the comments. But I'm here to tell you, be filled with the Holy Spirit. If I looked at Acts chapter 9, verse 17, and Ananias went to the house and entered it and placed his hands on Saul and said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared unto you on the road to Damascus when you were coming here, has sent me that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And Paul prayed, and I'm here to tell you that when he prayed, laid his hands on his eyes, my God, scales fell from his eyes, and he, in his blindness, went away. He began to see, being filled with the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And I'm here to tell you, when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, Acts chapter 15, verse 8 and 9, God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them just as he did to us. He made no distinction between them that had purified hearts with faith, the Jews and the Gentiles, God filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't matter what your zip code is, don't matter what your education or ethnicity, your race, your color, your creed, God has no respecter of person, but he is a respecter of faith. He is a respecter of your sacrifice. He is a respecter of your praise and your worship, but he is no respecter of person. He don't care who does it. You put the right praise there, he'll show up. You give the right seed, he gonna multiply it. Come on, oh yes. You get the right praise there, he'll show up in the midst. You get the right prayer, he's a respecter, my God, of those who obey his word. He will honor his word. And right now, if you need the Holy Spirit, I want you to lift your hands and say, Lord, I need the Holy Spirit. Fill my soul with the Holy Spirit. And I'm gonna pray for you. I'm going to pray with you. My God, I'm not out of word, just out of time. It's so much to deal with on this Pentecost Sunday. But I want you to know this is the day of power. Put in the comments, the day of power. This is the day of release. This is the day where debts are canceled. This is the day where prisons, doors are unlocked. And every band's prisoners are released. Oh, yeah, this is the year of the Lord's release. Power. It's an abundance. This is that year, Pentecost. Oh, yes. I'm here to tell you, as I'm praying for you, you need to ask God to fill your soul with the Holy Ghost. Fill your soul with the Holy Spirit. And every time in the New Testament, when you saw they were filled with the Holy Spirit, you always saw and they spoke with new tongues. It always accompanied in the New Testament, and they spoke with new tongues. Yes. I'm here to tell you, on the day of Pentecost, they began to speak with new tongues and different languages. And the folks that came from all over, from, I told you, Elamites and from Rome, and they came from Egypt, and they came from everywhere, Phrygia and proselytes, and they all came everywhere, but they heard these in upper rooms speaking in their language. They said, these men are filled with new wine. They're drunk. Oh, but Peter said, no, we're not drunk as you suppose. But this is spoken by the prophet Joel in the book of Joel chapter 2. In the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Now on all flesh. And they begin to speak with new tongues. He said, no. This is that Lord that you crucified, hung on the tree. He came back in the form. He can live in us. My God, is God in the form. He can indwell in us, the Holy Spirit. And they begin to speak with new tongues. And I'm here to tell you, you too will speak in the power of the Holy Ghost. Don't focus on the tongues. Focus on the gift that God has given you. And I'm here to tell you, my God, the tongues will come. The power is in the Spirit. The tongues is not the power. That's just one of the evidence that one has the Holy Spirit. It's not the only one, but it's one. Thank you, Jesus. If you got power, amen, to raise the dead, you can't do that by yourself. That's the Holy Spirit. My God. And I'm here to tell you, when God works, he does the super to our natural that we cannot do ourselves. And I feel the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus. I'm just glad. Last night I was at my mom's house and they called the paramedics and they worked on it and helped out. And then they went away. And then later on they had to call back. As I was leaving the house, they called back and took mom to the hospital. But I began to pray again in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Heal her body. Touch her from the crown of her head. If she's listening right now, and I know my sister BJ is in the hospital with her right now. If I'm on Facebook Live, bless you, Mom. I'm praying for you that God will touch you from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. Not only my mother, but everybody else that's watching. I didn't lay down this morning until 6:30 a.m. and back up in a couple hours so I could be here to do this Facebook Live. But let me help you. The power of God has my mother still here. Thank you, Lord. The power of God is still moving. The power of God is touching, is healing, and it's delivering right now. And so I speak the power of God in the name of Jesus. Father, I want to thank you as I pray right now. Come on, give me some prayer hands. Just some hearts up there in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you. If you need the power of the Holy Ghost, you need deliverance, you need healing, whatever it is you need in your life, I pray right now. The prayer of Peter that says, I'm casting all of my concerns, all of my cares on him, for he cares for me. And I thank you right now for these souls that want to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm praying you fill them, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Touch them, those that are in hospitals, convalescent centers, those that's lost loved ones, those that are in between jobs, whatever the need is, we give it to Jesus. We thank you right now. I thank you, Lord, that you are moved by your power, moved by your Spirit. Touch, heal, and deliver, and set the captives free. We call those things that be not, as I'm praying, that as though they were, as be not as though they were, we count it done. And we believe it now. Put in the comments, we believe it now in the name of Jesus. It is so. I said it is so. And so it is in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen. Come on, give God praise. Come on, give him praise. Hallelujah. I feel the Holy Ghost. I believe the power of God is moving right where you are. And I want you to receive Jesus as Lord if you have not done so. And say, Lord Jesus, come on, repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I need you in my life. I need an exchange. I'm giving you all of me, come on, so I can have all of you. And from this moment forward, my soul belongs to you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. Father, I thank you right now. It is so. Come on, just put some praying hands, some hearts out there. For all these souls that are joining the royal family. I'm excited to come to you today. I'm excited to be with you today. And I know you were blessed, know you were helped. Come on, we're going to sow some good seeds and good ground. Before I go, you need God to anoint your finances. What better time than right now when the power of God is moving for you to help me and help yourself to the things of God, that God would anoint your finances, that God will put super on your finances. James Cleveland sang a song years and years and years ago. He said, little becomes much when you place it in the master's hand. I want you to help me sow some good seeds. I'm going to do it right now and also electronically. you on the bottom of your screen, you can text in your offering. You can text it in. Text the letters CFE to the numbers 77977. That's right. Text CFE to the numbers 77977. Also, you can cash app us. You know how to do that. $, all lowercase. It's at the bottom of your screen. $ Christ for everyone, H. And the letter H stands for headquarters. $ Christ for everyone, H. And then, of course, the trusty mail still works. We're located. Right? This Christ for everyone, CFE, P.O. Box 399, Madison, Illinois, M-A-T-T-E-S-O-N, Madison, Illinois, 60443. It's at the bottom of your screen. And also, we're located. I'm in the Holy Cathedral today on Day of Pentecost, 276 East 16th Street, Chicago Heights, Illinois, 60411, 276 East 16th Street, Chicago Heights, Illinois, 60411. And somebody said, why is he saying it again if it's on the bottom of the screen? For my vision impaired saints and visitors, they say, thank you, Bishop, for doing that. Since I can't see it, when you rehearse it and say it again, I can make a mental note and then follow through. So again, 276 East 16th Street, Chicago Heights, Illinois, 60411. I'm not out of word, just out of time. I'm glad you tuned in today. This is Pentecost celebration time. Get ready for your debts to be canceled. I'm talking to my tithers. I'm talking to those that are seed sowers in the kingdom. Get ready. I'm talking to you on the day of Pentecost. God want to revive you. God want to help you. God want to deliver you. God want to set you free. So on Pentecost Sunday, what better time to sow some seeds so God can multiply it, give it back to you.